Good afternoon, everyone. I welcome you all to another.
So just a minute, sir. I have not admitted everyone. So, okay. Is it on live, sir?
Yes, it is live. Good afternoon, everyone. I welcome you all to another edition of Learn from the Masters. For today's session, we'll be having a talk on approach and management by Dr. Pallavi, who is a consultant in cornea and ocular services at Sankara Hospital, Bangalore. Over to you, Dr. Pallavi.
Thank you, sir. good afternoon, everybody. So we'll be speaking on the approach and management of chemical injury today. The outline of the talk is introduction, types of injuries, pathophysiology, classification of chemical injury, and staged management. So as we all know, the chemical injuries actually account to nearly 22% of ocular traumas, and 2/3 of these are the ones which occur in young and children, the economically productive group. Majority are actually preventable because they occur either at workplace or accidentally. Of all, the chuna or the lime is the most commonest alkali injury, which is a dreaded form in our country. So what are the common alkalis we know? We know the chemical names, but they are found in what? So like ammonia is found in cleaning agents, the potassium hydroxide in caustic, but the most dangerous of all alkalis is the sodium hydrox, also called as caustic soda, which is used in the drain cleaners. Lime is calcium hydroxide, which is seen in cement, mortar, or plasters. The common acids which are there are the car batteries, that is the sulfuric acid. And also this is the one which is used as the battery water in the inverters in the house. The strongest of the acids is the hydrofluoric acid. Now, what does the acid or an alkali do to the eye? Basically, acids are less harmful. When they come in contact with the cornea, they basically denature and precipitate the proteins of the tissue. Hence, this formed coagulum acts as a physical barrier to prevent further penetration. So the amount of injury degree is comparatively less. Saying so, the exception for this is the hydroxyfluoric acid, which is very severe and rapidly penetrates despite being an acid. The pathophysiology of alkali is slightly different. It's basically a lipophilic substance, and it saponifies the fatty acids of the cell membrane. Once it peels this off, it gets an entry towards the corneal stroma. Once it enters inside, it destroys the proteolytic ground substance as well as the collagen bundles. So there's a lot of necrotic material which is there. This damaged tissue, along with the released enzymes, will further perpetuate the cycle of chronic inflammation and necrosis. That's why alkali injuries are more dangerous. So ultimately, whether it's acid or alkali, what happens to the eye? So there are two aspects which occur irrespective of what it is. One is that it is necrosis of the conjunctival and corneal epithelium, and the other is disruption or occlusion of the limbal vasculature. Both of this lead to the loss of limbal stem cells, either partial or complete. Once there is loss of these stem cells, there is conjunctivalization of the cornea plus neovascularization of the corneal surface. With absence of the normal phenotype of corneal epithelium, it progresses to persistent epithelial defect and going on with sterile corneal ulcer, stem cell deficiency. This ultimately leads to occurrence of what we called as an opaque vascular cornea, ultimate sequel of a chemical injury. Let's now go to seeing the classification. Why are chemical injuries classified? Mainly, they are the guidelines to assess the severity of the chemical injury, because the severity degree guides us to approach to the treatment that's required in that particular degree of injury. And most important, the severity also gives us a prognostic value to what would be the outcome for us to understand, as well as for us to explain to the patient what to expect when such an injury occurs. So time immemorial, everybody knows there are two classifications. The oldest, the one which came up in 1965, Balin was the first one who actually brought this. It was modified by Roper Hall. This is called as the simple classification of chemical injury into four grades. Here two factors are taken. One is the limbal ischemia. Second is corneal involvement. And depending on the severity, it's graded. Let's see what exactly it is. Now let's imagine this as a schematic cornea. This is the iris or the pupil. So this is how the eye is. When you see in grade one, usually there is no limbal ischemia. You may have a small epithelial defect, a haze, or few DM folds, but all the structures inside are seen. Clinically, it would be something like this with lid edema, congestion, mild epithelial defect, or even absence of it. In grade two, what happens? There will be a limbal ischemia, which is around one third of the limbal area. Along with that, there may be some amount of corneal haze or edema, but you can still see the structures inside. In grade three, the limbal ischemia increases. It increases as much as more than half, but up to half, but not more than it. And the corneal epithelial defect has occurred. There's more haze, but still some amount of internal aspects can be seen. How would it clinically look? Something like this. This is a fluorescent stained eye. You can see that they are actually particulate matters which are sitting on the corneal epithelium here in the stroma, but still pupil and a cataractous lens is seen in this case. As you go from stage 3 to 4, what happens is more than half of the limbal stem cells or nearly 360 degrees of the limbal stem cells are destroyed and the whole cornea becomes opaque. You would not see anything. This is classically called as what we call as boiled fish eye appearance of the cornea. So this is how the basic classification of the chemical injury is considered. But what is very essential clinically for us to is what actually when we say it's limbal ischemia to know. So as you can see, this arrow is marking at a ground glass cornea, which is totally opaque and you cannot see anything. Now see at this arrow. And when you compare this arrow area to that of a little vessels here, this area is totally devoid of any vessels. This is the area of limbal ischemia, where the limbal vasculature is totally either occluded or it has been obliterated. What is this? Here you can see that there is conjunctival vessels which have totally gone, and you can see a blanched appearance and a shiny surface like this. This is the area of conjunctival necrosis, loss of conjunctival epithelium. Till 2001, we always followed the Roper Hall's classification, but with our understanding of chemical injuries and its clinical course, we have understood that it's not just the limbal ischemia or corneal involvement, but even the involvement of the conjunctiva makes a huge difference with respect to the outcome. That is when the new classification, that is the DUAS classification, came up. Now, how is DUAS different from that of the earlier? Here, it considers limbal involvement. The term is involvement and not ischemia. It includes both ischemic areas as well as direct injury, and it considers conjunctival involvement. This is assessed in DUAS by doing the staining of the conjunctiva, indicative of how much the conjunctival epithelium is lost. And what is very special about this classification is the analog scale. It looks numerical, but it is very simple. Just to give an example, when you say 0 by 0%, indicative, there is 0 clock hour of limbal involvement with respect to ischemia or limbal cells, and 0% means no conjunctiva is involved. When you make it 1 by 3, that means nearly 3 clock hours of conjunctiva involved. And when you say 20% or 29%, that is the percentage of the conjunctiva which is having necrosis. It is a simple thing, but the concept has to be very clear. If there is loss of the limbal stem cells, corneal epithelium will not grow. But the conjunctival epithelium can still grow on the cornea and make it vascularize, make it heal. And once it heals, it will remain at least like an healed area, which can later be managed. But if the conjunctiva also is necrotic and conjunctiva is lost, then the eye will go for progressive melt and the loss of an eye Am I audible? Am I
now?
Heard?
Yes. Yes. Now, yes.
Fine now.
Shall I go back, or was this the slide that was audible?
Can just go back one slide and go start again.
Was the duas class this? I was speaking about the difference in duas and ropahals.
We missed it. Can you specify that? Can you go on to the slide and the difference between duas and ropahals and continue?
Yes. Okay. So the difference. I think this part was clear with respect to the previous slide.
The dual classification was clear. After that, we lost your audio video.
Okay, sir. So I was just telling that there has been a randomized control trial study done, and they found that the duas is considered to be superior with respect to predicting the outcomes of the chemical injury. However, both of them are practically used. Now, with this, my slides are not moving. I just need a minute to go this. The slides are not moving. Yeah. So the immediate, now we will go to the immediate management of this. Yeah. So now we will lead to the management of chemical injury. And here it comes as intermediate, the immediate, early, and intermediate and late. What is the severity of ocular injury? It actually depends on the toxicity of the chemical, how long it is in contact with the eye, and it also comes with the depth of penetration, and last, the area of involvement. And for all this, the most important aspect is the history that we take, like what was the product? And it also tells us about whether there has been. Okay. Is it visible now? Am I audible?
Yes.
Okay. So the toxicity of the chemical, what it is, and how long was it in contact is an important history. Depth of penetration, like a touch with the hand to the eye with the lime versus a bursting of a lime packet, the impact is more because of the force with which the lime is released. So the importance is of the history and proper documentation of the same. Okay. So now, first thing first, always check the pH of the eye using the universal pH indicator and make sure it is neutralized to 7 to 7.2. Always wait 2 to 3 minutes before the checking, because sometimes the particulate matter may get released. Check the phonysis and double evert. Remove any particulate matter that is present inside the eye and stain the fluorescein and grade the patient. If possible, intraocular pressures should be checked. Irrigating fluid, whatever is available can be used when it comes as a first aid with respect to the patients. But when it is in the hospital, can you see this?
Yes, it's fine. Go ahead, Dr. Pallavi.
Sir, actually, once I go to the full screen, the slides are not moving ahead.
Okay, fine.
So the irrigating fluid, water, if available, should be used. But the water is to be understood. It is a hypotonic solution. And a hypotonic solution actually imbibes more water and causes more corneal edema and taking in of the acid or alkali. Whereas BSS, normal saline, ringer lactate, these are isotonic solutions which are known to be effective in irrigation. You need to irrigate to an extent till the pH comes down, or the standard is at least for 30 minutes for at least 3 liters. It may go as more if depending on the amount of the chemical impact. But ideal solution for this is a hypertonic solution called as the dipoterin solution. This dipotorin solution is a hypertonic and an amphoteric solution. Am I audible, sir? Am I audible?
Yes.
Okay. Can I continue?
Please do.
So, amphoteric means it can be used both for alkali as well as for the acid injuries. My slides are not moving ahead. Yes, what it does is it increases the osmotic pressure, mobilizes the water, and it dissolves the corrosives out of the corneal tissue. Apart from this, since it is amphoteric, it actually quickly neutralizes the corneal stroma to physiological pH. It helps in faster reepithelialization of the stroma and limits tissue damage, pain, and inflammation. So in most of the European countries, actually the dipotriodine solution is the ideal solution. If not available, whatever is available can be still used. Isotonic are better. This is a small chart to explain what actually happens when the patients go through the phase. The phase is like this, that in the first 1 week, the epithelium regrows. So the aim is to reduce the inflammation and encourage growth. Whereas in the second week, there is more of collagenolysis. So we have to make sure that we minimize the collagenase activity and increase the synthesis. In the last phase, the mild to moderate usually would have healed, but the severe would either melt, scar, or end up with a total limbal stem cell deficiency. So in the next stage, what we do is in the early acute phase is we have to do majority of them. It is the medical management. Am I heard?
Yes, you are audible.
Okay, so the steroid is the mainstay. Here we are using the prednisolone eye drops, which has to be put in mild cases in the form of 4 times a day, but in severe cases, as much as 1 hourly should be the dosage. Whereas here the steroid in the second week should be tapered down because it has got a negative effect on the stromal healing. So don't hesitate, even if epithelial defect is there, the steroids is a must. So next thing, what we would look at is the next medicine is the antibiotics. Antibiotic and ointment is better compared to a drop because it acts both as a lubricant and prevents superinfection. In grades severe, like grade 3 and grade 4, we can use the fluoroquinolones, whereas when it is the earlier form, even a simple ofloxacin is okay. Lubricants are used to make the patient comfortable. The role of vitamin C is either topical or oral. Topical 10% an hour in the first week is essential. Oral medications should be at least 2 grams 4 times a day in an adult. We always under treat in case of vitamin C, but in case of acute chemical injury, severe form, the dosage should be very, very high, provided the renal functions are good. Cycloplegics are used to reduce the pain of the patient. Now, going to the next slide. Doxycycline. Doxycycline is given during the second week. Basically, its function here is that of a inhibition on MMP as well as a scavenger of free radicals. So it helps in the healing and reduction of the inflammation. 100 milligrams BD for at least 1 to 2 weeks is what is advised. Avoided in children and pregnant or reproductive females. Medroxyprogesterone is a progestational steroid. It does not have the potency as much as that of the prednisolone, but it is very friendly to the stroma. So we can use it as a substitute after 1 week, if available, so that it takes care of the healing. There are reports which say that plasma-rich, platelet-rich plasmas or your seras can be prepared and used. And it is as an adjuvant, not a primary treatment. If pressures are high, then anti-glaucoma medication in the form of oral or topical beta blockers are advised. But if the condition is very severe, where you have it more than grade 3, that is where more than nearly, you know, 2/3 of the conjunctival ischemia has occurred, then only medical management may not be sufficient. That's when the role of amniotic membrane comes into picture. The dictum is as early as possible, the fresher the better. Mainly what it does is it has two-fold action. One, it physically gives comfort, prevents occurrence of simblepharon, and biologically, it promotes proliferation and differentiation of the cells, whatever are remaining, and it has its own inherent anti-inflammatory property. And it has to be made sure that if it is a child, you can use a simblepharon ring and put a tarsorrhaphy temporary suture so that the amniotic membrane takes care of a better healing. Some situations where it is not just the eye injury, but it is a massive blast injury where the patient cannot be taken to the OR. The other options of amniotic membranes are the use of Prokera, which is pre-mounted amniotic membrane, which is available. And in our country now recently, the Orolab has come with Oromister. This basically has two PMMA elliptical rings. In between the two, we have to sandwich a fresh amniotic membrane, and then it can be placed into the eye. The importance of amniotic membrane goes unsaid, that it not only helps in healing, but also prepares the eye for further surgical options and makes it easy because it provides a nice cleavage plane when we are doing the procedures later. There comes sometime a situation where, like you can see here, there's total blanching. That means there is absolutely no vessels even in the conjunctiva. These are few cases where you would require to do tineoplasty.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Dr. Saptagirish here. Reason why the video and audio is also not there is because of a very poor bandwidth, which is now because of everyone using the online video platforms. So of late, we've been having very poor bandwidths. So I think she'll just definitely come back online. There.
Sir, am I visible? Sir, can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Okay. Shall I continue ahead, sir?
Please do.
Okay. So, I don't know when this got disconnected. Shall I go back to the tineoplasty, sir, or do I continue ahead?
You can start with the tineoplasty.
Okay, sir. So I was telling that there may be some situations where there is extreme loss of conjunctiva and the necrotic material is there, wherein we need to advance the remaining tenons as well as the Yeah. Okay. So we basically have to advance the tenons as well as the adjuvant conjunctiva towards the limbus for re-epithelization. This helps in a better outcome. Tineoplasty actually is an old procedure, but recently it has come in again as a procedure to be looked for in very severe cases. Till now, we finished with the acute and intermediate management, but there are some percentage of these who would unfortunately, either because of absence of treatment or because of the degree of injury, would end up in a vascularized cornea or with secondary degenerative changes with simblepharon, thinning of the cornea, and also sometimes a distorted globe. So how do you manage these severe chemical injuries is what we will be looking at. So this is a traditional state. We know that if there is a unilateral limbal stem cell deficiency, then if it's partial, we normally do not do anything. If it is total and unilateral, we go for conjunctival limbal autograft. And if it is associated with a very little available tissue in the other eye, we go for a cultivated. Whereas if it is bilateral, it is usually either a live related or a cultivated variant. So the conjunctival limbal autograft, also called as CLAU, is where we basically take a superior and inferior 2 to 3 quadrant of keratolimbal tissue along with the limbus from one eye and place it to the affected eye with sutures. This is a known procedure and has very good results. The advantage being fresh tissue, technically easy, and no antigenic load. But the risk of iatrogenic limbal stem deficiency in the other eye is known. So if there is bilateral loss and you do not have a tissue to take, then the other option that came up was the cultivated limbal stem cells, where a small amount of tissue from the donor, either the patient himself or his relative, is taken. It is cultured in the lab and then placed back on the affected eye. The advantage here is, since small tissue is there, it will prevent the limbal stem deficiency for the donor. However, the disadvantage is you require a very sophisticated lab, and the cost of maintaining as well as licensing is huge. So these conventional procedures were later looked into as another option called COMET, where you don't have a lab for the limbal stem cells, but you do not have limbal stem cells also, then the oral mucosa is taken, and the phenotype of this is slightly tried to change to make it like that of the epithelium. The disadvantage is, despite changes done in the lab, the original phenotype is maintained and patients develop vascularization back again. So COMET has not been a successful surgical procedure for the limbal stem cell deficiencies. I'm just checking. Am I audible?
Yes. Carry on.
Okay. So, limitations of this conventional surgical options have been that it is risk of limbal stem cell deficiency. If we use cadaveric or live-related lifelong systemic immunosuppressant, which is not a practical or feasible option, and with COMET, it has been vascularization. So for this, we came up in 2012 with Sangwan et al. From LVP group with a simple novel procedure called as SLET, that is simple limbal epithelial transplantation. This has a combination of both the cultivated limbal cells as well as the conjunctival autograft, because tissue is small. But it also overcomes the limitation of both, that it does not produce limbal cell deficiency and the cost is not at all. So what do we do here? Basically here, there is a direct transplantation of tiny limbal fragments, which would be put on the area of effect over an amniotic membrane and allow it to grow in vivo. The proposed 3 variants which are now in vogue are the conventional SLET, which usually we do in unilateral limbal stem cell deficiency, allogeneic SLET when bilateral limbal stem cell deficiency is there, that is live related, or the cadaveric fresh allogeneic SLET, where the cadaveric fresh eyes are used to provide the limbal stem cells. I'm going a little in detail with SLET because it is a new procedure. Can I continue ahead?
Yes.
Okay, so coming to the contraindications of slits. SLET cannot be done in dry ocular surface because the outcome will not be good, nor we do in areas where there is presence of some amount of corneal keratinization. Now, disorganized anterior segments in the form of adherent leukoma, anterior staphyloma also are contraindication because the cells do not grow over an irregular surface and the success may not be good. Presence of any uncorrected adnexal pathologies like the lagophthalmos, ectropion, entropion can also be a preclude for not doing it. First, they have to be corrected and then we go ahead with the SLET procedure. So what is the technique? Basically, the very important 4 points I want to tell is when we take surgical consent in a SLET, the most important aspect we should always note is that we have to take consent for both the eyes. One, for the SLET procedure on the affected eye and the eye which is giving its tissue, that is the donor eye. It can be done under LA. In children, preferably it is done under general anesthesia. One of the success that is seen post-SLET is how much avascular the underlying bed of the amniotic membrane is. So pre-op, it is very essential that we use either some vasoconstrictors like the brimonidine or the phenylephrine at least 15-20 minutes prior to the patient being taken for the surgery. First, the affected eye, that is the pannus excision with amniotic membrane, either in the form of glue or suturing has to be done. The donor tissue, basically what we do is we take a small amount of tissue that is around 1 clock hour or roughly 3.5 to 4 millimeters of the tissue which is having more pigmentation. Superior limbus is better because it's having more limbal stem cells and it also comes under the lid if, in case there is some amount of pseudopterygium that forms there. This tissue is taken from the top. So I'll be showing a small video for you all to see how the SLET cells are procured. Is it visible?
Yes, yes.
After making a small conjunctival opening, we are holding the conjunctiva and then use the 50 number blade and gently we move ahead through at the limbus around where the, you know, limbal vasculature. It has to be a gentle procedure. We don't need to go deep. We don't need the stromal tissue there. And then gently with a blunt forceps and either with the venas or with the Westcott scissor, we cut the tissue from the top. It is a very gentle procedure and it can be even done under a topical this, but for the initial beginners, it is better to do under a block. Once this tissue is obtained, it is maintained in the balance salt solution, never allow it to actually dry. And once we get over the donor, here already amniotic membrane is placed. We have cut it into around 8 to 10 pieces and put it in the mid periphery to periphery. We don't place in the center. Then the fibrin glue is placed, waited for 1 minute, and then bandage contact lens is placed. What is very essential here is the epithelial side should be up. It will be usually pigmented and the stromal side will be white and non-glistening. That is how we'll be able to pick it up. Post-op care is, you have to give them steroids in the form of prednisolone. It's usually 6 times a day for a week and taper it over a period of 6 weeks. And the bandage contact lens is removed after 3 weeks. In children, you can keep it a little longer. Lubricants have to be added. In pediatric, it's good that the amniotic membrane is glued as well as sutured, plus a tarsography maintained for at least 2 weeks. Otherwise, loss of SLET cells is very common. Just to show you the timeline of how the SLET would work in a patient, if he is the kind of a candidate, like this is a grade 4 with a pannus and complete vascularization. After 1 week, you can see that the SLET cells are growing. Actually by 40 to 72 hours, you can see the cells still growing over the amniotic membrane. This is after 2 weeks, you can see the clearing of the central cornea, but still visible SLET cells are there, which are broader. This is a SLET picture of 2 weeks. Then at 1 month, you see most of the cells have nearly disappeared and the corneal epithelialization is very, very good and clear. This is at 3 months, the corneal vessels start absolutely going and it becomes avascular. And this is at 6 months period. So this is how a SLET would work, and it requires a time to wait and see how it slowly improves with time. SLET outcomes, how you say it has worked is basically that it should be stable, epithelialized, and avascular cornea. You would not get back the pristine cornea as before, but 80% of the surface is healed, and the success is known to be around 68 to 76% by literature. There are around 40 to 50% of patients who have corneal scars and stromal thinning who would require additional procedures like DALK or PK at a later date after the SLET has been done. Some patients who would have improved and have minimal haze would not require PK. A scleral contact lens can give additional benefit and no further surgery required. There would be 1 to 2% of patients in whom even a SLET cannot be done and bilaterally involved. In such cases, the last option when they are bilaterally dry and limbal stem deficiency, if it is dry, we would go for either the MOKP or type 2 Boston, or if it is wet but it is bilateral, you can go for the type 1 keratoprosthesis as a last option in managing these chemical injuries. So to conclude, acute chemical injury, the approach and management actually decides the long-term outcome, and management of severe chemical injury with amniotic membrane reduces complication and prepares the surface for further visual rehabilitation. SLET is a novel procedure. It is simple and has a profound potential for giving back vision. However, end-stage surgeries only meant for bilaterally affected eyes in whom such keratoprosthesis have to be done. Last but not least, the most important, the first step towards managing a chemical injury is preventing it from occurring, and that is through education and bringing about regulatory measures. So with this, I end my talk. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Pallavi. It's been a nice and wonderful talk, very comprehensively dealt. Of course, there's been little bandwidth issues. That's why the signal has had to get disconnected. Yes. There have been some questions. If you could just answer them. There's a question by Dr. Krishna Ogirala, who's asking the role of autologous serum in chemical injuries management.
Autologous serum, basically, you have to prepare from the patient's own. And it is proposed that basically, since it is platelet rich and it has a lot of anti-inflammatory properties, it basically helps in easing out the inflammation and also prevents the development of the endothelial growth factors, so neovascularization of cornea. However, it's more of an adjuvant and not a primary treatment in injuries.
Dr. Akshay Mitra has a question. He says, how much Defoterine needed for a wash?
Personally, I have no experience of having used a Defoterine, but what it is we have to understand is we have to bring the ocular cul-de-sac pH somewhere to the physiological, that is 7 to 7.2. If we are able to get it to that level, then that is the point we can stop. So there's nothing like this much only has to be. Actually, Defoterine is very, very costly solution in the first place. So we have to mainly make sure that the pH is brought under control.
Right. Dr. Prabhakar has a question. He's asking, are topical vitamin C drops available?
To my best of knowledge, I think 3 to 4 years back, Orocitrate, that is again the Orolab, were manufacturing the vitamin C eye drops, but I'm not very sure it's available. You can prepare the same vitamin C with the use of the injection vitamin C available and dilute it to 10%, like any other fortified medicine. Only thing is you have to change it early in 4 to 5 days and keep it in the fridge.
Dr. Rahul has a question. He's saying, is there any use of glass rod coated with lubricating gel for clearing lead adhesions?
Yes, obviously. It's basically to prevent those two raw areas coming in contact. So it is the traditional way of use of the rod in prevention of the simblepharon. If it is usually, if it is so very severe, that's why where we go and do the AMT, where AMT goes all the way under the fornix and we keep a simblepharon ring. Yes, glass rod is very useful. It can be used.
Dr. Kulkarni has a question. He says, what are the intraoperative complications of SLET?
I can put it as the donor and the host. In the eye which pannus is being excised and we are planning for the slit. That's why I always take the donor tissue later. Sometimes when we are trying to remove the pannus, you can have a perforation. And when you have a corneal perforation, the slits don't do well. So very thin and perforation is known to occur. Extensive bleeding under the amniotic membrane is other intraoperative complication because it's a very vast. That's why we don't use or do slit in an inflamed eye. And in the donor area, buttonholing, loss of limbal stem cells sometimes because it's very tiny tissue and you just take it and by the time you transit and you can have it falling. These are the most important complications and sometimes excess glue that falls over the surface.
Dr. Monica has a question. She's asking any advantage of the sandwich technique in SLET where limbal stem cells are placed between two layers of amniotic membrane?
Advantages, it is like it's a surgeon's comfort. If you would want to make sure that the BCL may not take care of it, but what my personal experience is when we try to actually sandwich, there will be some amount of dead space that gets created. And if some edge of the amniotic membrane is sometimes loose, there may be some tear film getting in and the whole purpose of doing a sandwich may not help. But if you would 100% put it double layer and then put a suture for the or layer, that's no problem. But there's nothing as such. It's just a reassurance to you. But I'll tell you, if you do a good dry surface, put a very nice amniotic membrane, tug it under the edges of the conjunctiva on the periphery, put limbal sutures and put minimal fibrin and thrombin and wait for a minute, the slit cells will sit very well. In adults, it will sit. In pediatric, you'll have to put a tarsorrhaphy.
Dr. Sri Ramcharan has a question asking in SLET, the limbal stem cells need basement membrane for proliferation and a niche. Amniotic membrane is used for it or BCL itself is only sufficient?
No, the concept here is that the amniotic membrane acts like the basement membrane. It acts like the scaffold on which these epithelial cells grow. And the property of the stem cells is they will always go to their niche area. There is the limbus, the palisades area where these cells ultimately they proliferate and later reach to the limbal area. So amniotic membrane is a must when you're doing a slit. BCL is just a mechanical support to prevent the dislodgement of the cells.
Dr. Vaibhav is asking in which grade or phase autologous serum is helpful in chemical injuries?
I think anything beyond stage three, where you know that the inflammation is extensive and very good when you have the sterile non-healing epithelial defects. It has a very good role in the epithelial healing also. So that is where probably I would use an autologous serum.
Right. Dr. Anirudh has a question. He says, use of BCL in early management of an injury.
Yes, it can be used with precaution, but with an antibiotic coverage, BCL can be used even with a chemical injury with epithelial defect.
And Dr. Preeti is asking if injectable vitamin C is not available, can we dissolve oral preparation and use it as an eye drop?
Actually, Dr. Preeti, the thing is oral vitamin C, what we have observed is the non-dissolving variant. We have tried, but it usually does not come as good as the IV injections. The sodium ascorbate is what is the drop which is prepared. What vitamin C we have is the non-dissolving, the tablet chewables. So you can, but it is it doesn't nicely dissolve.
Right. And Dr. Raghavendra Rao Jigardar Jagirdar is asking, where do you place limbal cells in SLET?
As I showed you in the video, you have to place it in the mid-periphery, which is the ideal position for the slit cells to be placed. The rationale is if you place in the center, sometimes if the amniotic membrane gets covered up or the cells are not the cells, but you have more of the corneal stroma, opacity can occur. Second thing is in case secondary procedures like central PK and ALK has to be done, you would be still preserving these cells in the periphery. That's why it is in the mid-periphery or periphery, never in the center.
Right. Dr. Yash is asking, is there any role of N-acetylcysteine in treatment of chemical injury?
Mucolytic, basically it's a mucolytic, not very sure. You can use it, but not very sure.
Right. Dr. Ankit has a question. He's asking, is 1% medroxyprogesterone commercially available? And how it works in chemical injury and any specific indication for it?
When I was doing my fellowship, that was the time where we used to see them. After that, I have not seen. I personally don't know whether it's commercially available. But as I told you, see, it's a progestational steroid. So it is an anti-inflammatory. So it has the role. If it is available or it can be constituted from the ones which are used in the gyne, it probably plays a role. But I have not personally seen it commercially available. No idea, actually.
Dr. Anand Dayan is a question, in which grade of chemical injury you would advise anti-glaucoma drugs?
It's like this is more of a practical way of looking at it. Anytime we know that there has been beyond, two thirds of limbal ischemia or a direct penetration. Sometimes we see like, you know, the whole cornea is white. Usually in this trabeculitis is there and we, young patients, I rather in pediatric cases, by default, I maintain them on anti-glaucoma after grade three. So grade one and two, until unless they are steroid responders, I think it is not required.
There's a question by Dr. Devakani. She's asking, can you please advise as to what is to be done by a person who witnessed such incidents to prevent further damage before reaching the emergency hospital, like tips for teachers or nurses in the school?
Yeah, probably a doctor has to be prepared. The only thing is, the most important is the eye wash. That is the holy grail of emergency management. Because take out the primary material in the eye and the eye wash has to be done. The only thing which probably everybody should know is we don't irrigate if it is an open globe. Like in a firecracker injury, which also is a chemical injury, we normally cannot irrigate because the eye sometimes is, you know, open globe. So, but when it is a primary treatment, they you have to use the water, whatever is available, but sterility is an issue, but still something is better than nothing. So water and immediate first aid to be sent to the nearby ophthalmologist. I hope I answered the question.
Yes. Dr. Vidharthi Devakaran is asking, is there a role of citrate drops in chemical injury? And if yes, can you please explain the mechanism?
See, citrate is basically a chelator. It's a chelator. And so it basically prevents the proteolytic enzymes are being inhibited by it. So it actually helps in collagen reformation along with vitamin C. So that's how it is. Yeah.
Okay. And Dr. Anushree is asking, within how many days do you prefer to taper off the steroids?
For what, sir?
I guess she wants to know how many days you would want to taper these steroids. Topical steroids is what I guess.
Depending on the grade, as I said, if it is mild, you're using 3 to 4 times a day and then you can weekly taper it. If it's very severe, you would have to take it again weekly, but the dosage is 1 hourly. Then you make it 8 times, 6 times, then 4, 3, 2, and 1, depending on how much is the inflammation or residual that is left. So if it's very severe, we may maintain them for even 2 to 3 months also.
Right. Dr. Aparna is asking, what is the role of systemic steroids in acute management?
Systemic steroids in acute management, I think it is a little overkill because it is mainly in the eye and it's on the surface in majority. And I probably think it would be not of a great beneficial factor because it is not even recommended. But I think post-op, post-surgical, we use it, but not usually in a severe grade of chemical injury. Systemic, no.
And Dr. Nischala Rama is asking, which anti-glaucoma medication is advisable in chemical injuries?
I think I said it's a beta blocker is better.
And Dr. Bindya Prakash is asking, is umbilical cord serum or autologous serum better in ocular chemical injuries?
I don't know about the umbilical cord serum, but patient's own serum, that is why it is called autosera. And when you say umbilical cord, it will be somebody else's, then that itself has its own issues with antigenicity and all that. So autosera is still the better.
Right. And Dr. Akshay is asking, patient is on lots of topical medication for a long time. Can ocular surface healing be further affected? And any way to reduce the burden of medications?
Yeah, that is why, see, the rationale is the aggressive treatment has to be for the first 1 week to 10 days. After that, depending on how much the epithelium is healing, the steroid has to be tapered. Rather, if you feel that the steroid is the reason for non-healing, you can change from high-potent steroids to a milder variants, which are surface soft drugs. Some of the steroids may not be very good for the surface. It itself may produce more epithelial damage. So multiple medications not required. A lubricant, a maintenance antibiotic, an aggressive steroid is all that is required in this. So there's no need for adding anything extra in them.
Right. And Dr. Vandana is asking, prednisolone or dexamethasone, which is your preferred steroid in chemical injury?
Prednisolone.
Are there any more questions? Is it? I don't see any other questions.
Okay, sir.
Thank you very much, Dr. Pallavi. It's been a wonderful talk and very comprehensively covered of all the chemical injuries and the effect on the eye. In spite of all the small breaks that we've had because of the bandwidth issues, it's been very nice. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much for the support. I hope it was useful for you.
Yes, yes, very much. And for tomorrow's session, we'll be having Dr. Malik, who's our consultant at Shimoga, Sankara High Hospital Shimoga, will be talking on essentials of keratoconus. And the time remains the same. It's from 12 p.m. to 1 p.m. And the link is also the same. So see you all tomorrow and take care.